I repeat, it's wonderful to be here. It's been a very interesting workshop so far. I'm going to talk about something which is a little bit different in the sense, well, it's within the workshop. I'm trying to take lattice gauge theory and make it more amenable to doing conformal field theory. And conformal field theory often likes to live on not flat spaces. In fact, so that's the idea. I want to extend conformal field theory. Lattice gauge theory. And so I showed this when I was in Spain. So the idea is we've been trapped in flat land, and I want to go out in a new direction, like Columbus. And I thought this was totally inappropriate until I remembered that Columbus was actually trying to go to India. So sometime when you go one place, you find something new, even though you don't know where you're going. And that was clearly the case with Columbus. So the motivations, maybe you don't have to say it very quickly, is that conformal field theories are often more interesting when you put them on a sphere, and you can look at things like central charge. Radial quantization puts a conformal field theory on a cylinder. This was pointed out by Accardi a long time ago in 2D, and a cylinder is flat because it only has a circle. But if you want to go along beyond 2D, you have to have a cross section, which is a sphere. So it's nice to try to see if you can do this. But then this just raised the issue to me of, can you in general define a renormalizable field theory on a curved manifold using lattice discretizations? And it is known that any renormalizable field theory, ultraviolet renormalized fixed point, can also be renormalized on a smooth Riemann manifold. So the perturbative problem has been solved in perturbation theory, so it's not stupid to try to complete it, okay? So that's the question. The advantage to going to a cylinder sounds really dramatic, because when you do down the cylinder, it's the dilatation operator, so the spectrum is exactly the data that you want to get. And the other thing is, from the point of view of your original lattice, you're moving in log distance, and so if you have 100 points, you're exponentially farther along in real space. So I actually think this is the way it works. One should try to investigate conformal field theories, at least for some questions. Okay. Now, there's two steps in this, and they have a long tradition. One is that you need to approximate the curved manifold. That is essentially the goal of Reggie calculus, except Reggie calculus wants the geometry to fluctuate like mad and somehow be quantum gravity. I want exactly the reverse. I want the triangulation to hug as cleanly as possible the target manifold. If it's a sphere, I want to wrap it around. I want it to be as close to the right thing as I can, and I don't want to take ensemble averages. I just want to converge to that manifold. The next thing you need to do is that, since your lattice is not uniform, the simplicial or the Reggie approach is to always use simplexes, triangles in two dimensions, tetrahedrons in three dimensions, and so on. That has a great advantage. But you must then try to figure out how to put fields on top of this. And there is an absolutely huge literature, you can Google it, 18 million hits for finite elements. You can solve differential equations on arbitrary spaces with a discretization dictated finite elements. And it's guaranteed in the infrared to converge to the right solution if you do it right. And it's a complicated thing. But the basic idea is that just like the Reggie calculus has the fiction that each triangle has no curvature. It's a linear flat space. Then you do the same thing when you put a field on it, and the field magnitude, say, is at this point, but it falls linearly to all the points that are adjacent to that point, okay? This is, in fact, exactly a higher dimensional generalization of the trapezoidal rule for integration in one dimension. I was going to try to do one dimension, but it's hard to make a curved manifold in one dimension. It's the trapezoidal rule, basically lifted to a higher dimension. Okay. So, how do you go? Let's first look at free theories. Free theories, all you have to do is find out how to represent the Laplacian. And the final solution, applying finite elements in 2D, is very natural. If you want to put a finite difference between this point and this point, of course, the action should be certainly the difference of those two fields squared. And then it's actually divided. This is the rule that comes out of this machinery. It's divided by the distance squared along this thing, and it's given the area of this diamond. Now, that diamond is not arbitrary. This line here goes between the circumcenters of the triangles, okay? And indeed, this construction in two dimensions is actually can be realized by a discrete exterior calculus. So there's a nice sort of discrete version of geometry that gives this. Interestingly enough, the standard finite elements in 3D do not coincide with the discrete calculus, but though, so some people, and I go along with this, jump and use the discrete calculus and sort of call it finite elements, although it's kind of an abuse of words. Okay, so that's Laplacian. Now, I just want to, this is just basically maybe for your amusement. So this is a general thing. You start with points, lines, triangles, and so on. Then the dual lattice is constructed by taking the centers of the lines, and then the centers of the triangles, and then the centers of the tetrahedrons. The point is that if you think about this, it turns out all of these directions are orthogonal, and that allows you to get a very nice formula. So for example, oops, sorry, the area, of a simplex and its dual, so in the case of the this thing, this simplex was this line, and its dual was the line between the circumcenters. And this diamond area, it's orthogonal always, and it has this nice formula. Here's the sort of thing you can have a discrete version of Stokes' law. You can have discrete versions of these operators. And this is the actual form of the wave equation that I wrote down. And actually, Andy and I are trying to do it for the Cayley-Dirac equation, which also can be written that way. Now, having said that, let me now start with the most regular lattice. This is just for your sort of amusement. If you build something out of triangles, so P is equal to 3, then the rule is that 1 over P and 1 over Q is got to be greater than a half, where Q is the number of lines that come into the vertex. Now, if you're fast and think about this, you'll discover that there's three solutions, Q equals 3, 4, and 5. And quiz, what is that? What structures do you get with that? Positive curvature. Platonic solids. 3 is a tetrahedron. 4 is the, what is the fourth? Octahedron, yes. And the icosahedron is another one. Now, actually, you can make this into squares, and you get the whole platonic solid. But notice it's a finite series of symmetries of a sphere. In flat space, it's equal to half. And the only solution of triangles is Q. It's a triangular lattice. But if you put a quarter and a quarter, it's a square lattice and so on. And it's amusing that if you go to hyperbolic space, this is less than a half. And there's an infinite number of regular tessellations of hyperbolic space, which is something I'm looking into. And it relates to a wonderful, this is now, these spaces represent a finite subgroup of the modular group. So these are finite subgroups of the isometries of the space you start with. So this is a very natural thing to do. Okay, but now going to the sphere, which is the only, truth in advertising. I'm going to set up a machinery which I hope is general. My goal is that I'm trying to find the rules for putting any field theory, normalizable field theory, on a manifold. However, my test case is exactly one case, the usual one. I'm going to put phi 4 theory on a sphere and reproduce the two-dimensional icing model conformal field theory. And since we have the exact answer, I can show it works. I hope this is not a singular case. So how do we do that? Well, we take the most regular subgroup of the sphere, which is the icosahedron. That's as far as you can go. And then you take each of these faces and you break them up into equilateral triangles if they're flat. But if you solve that theory, you're actually finding the field theory on an icosahedron. If you want it to not be on an icosahedron, you take the center of this thing and you blow them up onto the sphere, giving them unit radius. That means that each triangle is slightly distorted. As you see, it looks very nice. So this is what I mean by, well, the geometry is as flat as close as I can to a sphere, because each of these triangles is treated as flat. And there, so this is my very regular Reggie representation of a sphere. Now, that does affect the weights in the Laplace operator. It's not just, you know, phi 1 minus phi 2 across each length. The result is that here is what it would be if I had, here's what it would be if I only put unit weights across all the finite differences. In other words, I'm really doing the icosahedron, okay? And what happens is there's a subgroup, the icosahedral subgroup, so the singlet is 1, the triplet is perfect, the 5-state, the L equals 2 state is perfect, but then you see this is a huge breaking, so that shows that the icosahedron is not a sphere. Once you put it in with this finite element thing, here is the 5 and the 7 and so on, these are the L equals YLM modes on the sphere, and they get very good. And in fact, they're provably good if you're careful. Here, for example, is a dispersion relation where each of the sub-triangles is broken up into 8-squared sub-triangles. S is the refinement. And here is, but this is averaging over this is the L quantum number averaged over M. That's usually the way people cheat. The actual spectrum is like this. It looks perfectly nice here with degeneracies. And then this is the breaking of spherical symmetry as you get close to the cutoff. On the other hand, if you look at the low part and you go to high refinement, this is, say, the fit to the dispersion relation, L times L plus 1. And it converges to the exact answer. My claim is that, although it's hard to dig it out of the literature, is that the proper treatment of finite elements guarantees exact convergence for any eigenvalue fixed as the cutoff goes to infinity. That's the statement that you get the classical equations right for the free theory. Okay, so now, having gotten that way that far, you can. I decided also to see if I could put a fermion on the sphere. Now, it turns out this is even more subtle and fun. Essentially, as far as I could see in the literature, no one had really succeeded in putting a fermion on a Reggie manifold because they had a problem. The curvature, since all of the triangles are flat, or simplices are flat, the curvature is at the corners, or in higher dimension, at the edges. But that means that the sites that you might want to put your fermion in a natural lattice doesn't have a tangent plane. So usually they would move the fermions into the center of the triangle, sort of breaking the standard formalism I want, where gauge links are on the lines and they're gauge invariant at the point. It turns out that that's not necessary. The Reggie geometry doesn't really tell you what the curvature is between the points. It's completely defined by the graph and the statement of lengths. That's the entire geometry of a Reggie manifold. Given a graph, how the triangles or simplices fit together, and given the lengths of the bonds, that is the only thing you can say about the manifold. So you can imagine an interpolation of the manifold which moves smoothly the curvature singularities into the bulk. You then can set up the tangent planes, describe a fermion, and then go back in the interpretation of your weights, these areas, to the flat case, and everything is still good to order a squared. But we're never going to get things better than a squared. So it turns out that's okay, and the result is that here is the discretized form of a fermion, a Wilson fermion, on a general manifold. You see what happens. These are the spin connections which have been turned into, like Wilson matrices for color, they are turned into compact matrices in the spin group. Here is the tetrad, and notice that it has to be associated with one sign. So this is the tetron at the tangent plane at I, and this one, just by choice, is the tetrad at J. But there has to be a consistency that if I parallel transport the tetrad from here to the other side, that it matches the one on the other side. That's called the tetrad hypothesis. This is exactly obeyed on the lattice, and that is the discrete version of the tetrad hypothesis. And this is completely gauge invariant. Gauge invariance means that I can pick any tangent plane I want. So this is a perfectly good thing. You need to add a Wilson term. The Wilson term is analogous to the standard one. The usual Wilson term is to add a second derivative, a covariant second derivative. Here you also add a covariant second derivative. You put it down on the thing, gives you a perfectly good Wilson term. And then the spectrum, let's not look at the left-hand side, look at the right side. The spectrum is this. It turns out that a fermion, a Dirac fermion on the sphere, has two states with exactly, well, it's been scaled, but the two states have energy a half for a unit sphere. And then there's four states here and so on. This is actually gives you the right spectrum for the analytic solution of a fermion on a sphere. Okay, so then, having got a fermion on a sphere, it occurred to us, of course, is that the Ising model is actually a theory of free fermions in some sectors, right? So you now just calculate the four-point functions using free fermions. If you use all free fermions, it's just the sum of the ST mu channels. It's trivial. You get the right answer. But more interestingly, you can introduce twist operators for the sigma operator. And a twist operator in the sphere means that the transport of the fermion around, say, the north and south pole, that's a perfectly good place to put it, instead of coming back to itself, comes back to a minus sign. So what it's really doing is it's puncturing the sphere and turning it into a cylinder topologically. That gives you a, so you can then solve the fermion. You have to be careful to project out the Majorana piece. But again, the answer is that you get a very good fit to the exact Ising solution for these free fermions on this manifold. And if we were, you know, really greedy, we could go through other higher genius and go to town, but it's enough. Now, I just want to point out that it's already been the scheme for putting a non-abelian gauge theory on a random lattice has already been done a long time ago by these gentlemen, 1982. They did a lot of interesting stuff. The only thing they didn't do is they didn't, they had random triangulation in flat space. They didn't try to lift it into curved space. But fortunately for bosons, you hardly know the difference. It's really only fermions that are very much sensitive to the fact that the manifold is curved. Okay, so now, all right, so the next, so the final part, what I've achieved at this point is the ability to build a classical Lagrangian, that is to say, a discretization on an arbitrary manifold, which will give the exact solution to all classical equations, give the exact solution to the equations of motion if the wavelength is below the cutoff. Any smooth solution, whatever, it's a kink or whatever I want, finite elements guarantees that I have a classical Lagrangian that works. The problem is I want to get the rightly normalized theory here and have it flow up to the Wilson-Fisher fixed point. And the perturbation theory is sick in this theory because there are ultraviolet divergences. So no matter how good my infrared model is, it knows about the cutoff. So what happens is the following. I'll skip this. This is the projection under the sphere. Everybody must know this. Okay. So what happens is the following. We didn't sort of realize this at first, so we tried to tune the mass, the relevant parameter, to the critical surface using a standard criterion, which is called the Binder cumulant. And if it were a normal theory in a cubic lattice, you would tune the mass and you would finally find a trajectory that would go directly in here. This is the exact answer. You'd actually find a trajectory that would go and stabilize right here, okay? And what happens is that nothing stabilizes. You think you're going to say this one looks like you must be at the critical surface, and you might draw it close to that or here. But you find, no, it goes up. It's not on the critical surface. Then you come down, and you think, well, now we must be on the other side of the critical surface. And you say, oh, wait, no, make change its mind, goes up. In fact, I think it keeps oscillating. So what's happened is the following. What's happened is that the average of phi squared, say, as a measure of order, is different close to the poles where the triangles were less distorted as they pushed them onto the sphere than on the triangular surfaces where they're more distorted. Another way of saying that is that my cutoff is different at different parts of the lattice. So I do not have a universal cutoff. So I have to actually fix this thing. The fear would be you have an infinite number of parameters to adjust, right? Because every point has got a different cutoff, and this is not, it's fine-tuning gone to hell, okay? But The fact is that that didn't happen. Instead, if you look at the 2D theory, there's only one diagram, the one loop diagram, which has a logarithmic divergence. And the logarithmic, this is just inverting the actual Laplace propagator that is in the on my action, right? I'm doing perturbation theory by hand for the one loop diagram as it my bare Lagrangian dictates, right? I calculated, and fortunately, this coefficient here is exactly the continuum value. So the divergence is not sensitive to all of these errors that I'm making at the cutoff. However, the scheme, the additive constant, I can bring this into a standard form, there is a constant which is dependent on the sort of effective cutoff wherever I am. So that's a typical scheme dependence. I have different cutoffs at different places. I haven't got a single scheme. What I can do is I can subtract this to order lambda and put it back as a real counter term in my action so that when it's generated, it's canceled. Now the question is, have I established a single scheme? And so the rest of the 3 minutes is to show that that works. Okay. I guess I'll skip this. We can have any questions. So a check on this is that this is the function which is being subtracted off. Actually, notice that it's actually the log of the local volume. Square root of gx is the local volume assigned to a lattice point, actually the dual volume. And so this is the thing you get. The second loop shouldn't be divergent. And sure enough, as you go to more and more refined, you decide that you see that it's converging rapidly to something which is independent. This is basically a measure of what lattice point you're on. This is telling you how big the triangles are at point x. So it's working. And I'll maybe take this as a question. There is actually, I couldn't find anything in the literature that would explain why this log was universal. It turns out that you can actually prove it rather easily if you think more like a renormalization group. Namely, you know that the Green's function has a good spectrum at low spectral infrared, and all its problems are here. If instead you take derivatives and think of this thing as a renormalization for the mass term, then you can see that all of the stuff that's noisy here is going to zero, and the actual contribution comes from this low part and dominates, because once you've taken the derivative, it now converges. It doesn't see the ultraviolet, the standard use of renormalization group. And that actually proves that this is not just an accident, but it's the continuum. Okay. Now, in my last few minutes, let me show you that we compared the icing model or the conformal field theory on the sphere once we had done this correction. We run Monte Carlo with cluster algorithms and the standard machinery. And so here is the first test. You actually know the exact Binder cumulant. This is the sixth cumulant because you know the four-point function on the plane. You transfer it entirely to the sphere. You integrate over all the coordinates, and you get the fourth moment of the momentum of the magnetization. So you can analytically calculate the value of the Binder cumulant. This is a finite volume, right? The Binder cumulant is it's the entire space that's giving the Binder cumulant. So this is an analytic thing. And this is our answer. This was the fit numerically. This is the exact answer. You have to actually compute it by computing an integral. Here's the sixth cumulant. Here's the thing we got. Clearly, we're not only seeing the critical surface, but we're seeing the right critical surface. You can also look at the two-point function. This is the two-point function. This is moments of it. These are the fits of the moments and extrapolated to zero lattice spacing, and they're all, I'm sorry, this is the defect, the difference between the numeric and the analytic one. It's going to zero. I think more interesting is we then started to think about the four-point function, partially because I wanted to see if we went to higher dimensions, whether we could actually get the kind of data that the bootstrap gets. We can look at the four-point function, we can get the anomalous dimensions and the coupling constants. And indeed, here is the four-point function map. And then we decided, suppose we didn't know, it's kind of a toy problem, suppose we did not know the exact answer for the four-point function, and we leave free the coupling constant to epsilon and the energy momentum tensor and the dimension here, the dimension of this operator. could we then use the data to find the answer to the icing model in the OP expansion? Now, of course, we're putting in a lot of information, but we're not alone doing that. And here's the answer. We fit the data. This dimension should be 1, and it's close to 1 in our fits. This should be 1/4, and it's close to 1/4. And this is the coefficient of the energy momentum tensor, which gives us the central charge. And this central charge should be 1/2. So we're hopeful, it's not a proof, that our system here, I'll skip this. We're hopeful that this generalizes. And let me just show the kind of generalizations. We want to go to a 3-sphere. This is kind of amusing. The 3-sphere, the most symmetric 3-sphere, has 600 tetrahedrons. And it was Aristotle said this was impossible. He's wrong. So this is a very nice starting point, which we'd again have to refine. I've also been looking at tessellating ADS space. And indeed, this is exactly the space of the last talk we just heard. And if we can deal with this tessellation well enough, we could start to solve the bulk problem that was mentioned. I'd like to talk to you more and see if the bulk problem then matches to the conformal field theory on the boundary. In general, I'm interested in thinking about what is a matter field. Of course, it really, you should have gravity, but any field you put into ADS space will enforce the isometries of conformal symmetry. It will be a solution, I think, to the bootstrap. I don't think it'll have any problems with unitarity. God knows what it'll have in terms of an energy momentum tensor, but there is a sort of interesting thing if we can do this in ADS space, that we can create numerical solutions to the bootstrap that are complete and maybe crazy. Now, maybe there's some fixed parameters that will give us interesting conformal field theories, but maybe there's just all kinds of families of conformal field theories, much like the long-range model we heard about. There's a zoo out there, and we can approach the zoo from the other direction. Thanks a lot.
Questions?
Yeah.
You, for the sphere, you could have gone to the buckyball, which is a lot more vertices. They're not exactly uniform triangles, but you could have triangulated that afterwards, which is much higher number of vertices.
I think, in effect, we did that. I mean, I put as many triangles as I wanted, I could uniformly, and then I distort them onto the sphere. What you do is, it's, even if you had the buckyball.
You could have began with the buckyball.
No, but it would be the same thing, basically. Yeah. Suppose I took the buckyball and I put a sphere around all the points that were at unit radius. I would find some points that were not on the sphere. I would pull them out, which is just what I did, and I would find the buckyball lengths would change. Those little lengths would change my Laplacian. The Laplacian was dependent on exactly the lengths in the denominator and the dual area. And that would just be another example of what I did. And there's no one example. In fact, you could be interesting. You could actually do something much more noisy from the point of view of finite elements. I could take points on the sphere and make them random but reasonably regular. There's a rule in finite elements called, shape regular, which means don't make it too bad, okay? Have all your triangles shrink together uniformly and never be long and skinny, okay? Within some bound, it's supposed to be guaranteed that you will get the right answer. So, and by the way, very, very few things are written down very carefully in these 18 million papers, as far as I can do. So it'd be actually good to investigate, really, where is the boundary of disorder? I think that in 2D, we know we can use random triangulation and do very well. But in a higher dimension, we know that random triangulation blows away the matter fields and gets you totally strange results. Now, if you think it's gravity, then you're looking for strange results, and it's a very interesting problem. But here, the question is, how noisy can it be before you don't converge to the right solution?
Just a second question. Is that, did you try calculating Casimir energies?
No, not yet.
It could be interesting to look at.
There's a million things to do. Actually, I should go to my last slide, which would really explain the problem. There really are. you have to start, unfortunately, rewriting lattice gauge theory somewhat from scratch. Now, in principle, if the people who wrote lattice gauge theory had done a beautiful thing, we would slip this geometry underneath everybody's code, and then all of the algorithms on top would be basically the same. I mean, the Wilson fermion, for example, I can put an extra dimension and make it a domain wall or overlap. There's really nothing beside the geometry and the definition of this bare Lagrangian that is unique to this formulation. However, I'm involved with people who write great software, and I can't see any way to do that. We've got to have to build it ourselves. But all the algorithms we will have for free. But there's many, many problems. Low-dimensional problems are huge numbers, yes? Oh, yeah, that would be interesting, yes? You want to join the collaboration? I'll hand you the code and we'll look at it. No, I'm not being, yes, the answer is a very good idea to look at that. What are my choices now? What I want to do is actually the problem that we set out at the beginning and do the 3D icing model. That's, I think, the one that we're really working on in the collaboration. But I think that's a very good thing. I'm worried about, I didn't go into it, but I want to make sure this counterterm is not special to two dimensions. In three dimensions, there's two divergent terms. There's a linearly divergent term, which actually doesn't actually one loop diagram actually doesn't worry me. There's a logarithmically divergent term, which is a two loop term. And we have checked the following, which is good news, and that is that even the two loop the departure from spherical symmetry of the two loop term is exponentially falling off with separating the two points in the lattice spacing, which means in principle you can make it a local counterterm because the higher moments are extra factors of A. In other words, as A goes to zero, it's becoming local. So we've checked that we can represent the two loop term as local. You see, they're going to be in higher dimensions, they're going to be more diagrams. To say nothing of if it's not super renormalizable, there's an infinite number of diagrams, so then we'll have to go to renormalization group methods to renormalize it.
One last question.
Yeah.
I understand your surface is fixed.
Yes, my.
So that, but you will you just eventually sum them up also?
Well, there's so many hours in the day. It's very interesting, of course. Look, if you let the surface, of course, shake a little bit, you're now doing weak gravity, right? The metric that we have on the surface is one of the fields. What we have is a frozen, fixed metric on the surface. If I let all of these things shake a little bit, I will then have gravitons that move across, and I'll couple gravity to matter. If I let them shake a lot, then who knows what happens? This is the question of whether Reggie formalism, Simon Catterall and his collaborator is looking at this. Or Simon, he's not here. Okay. And so there's a sort of reflip thing, is that the random triangulation has always run into problems of incredible instability. You're not getting anything like flat space. So it's quite possible that putting matter on the Reggie calculus helps stabilize it. So at first, from my point of view, the geometry is destabilizing the thing I want to see. But on the other hand, if you put enough matter, maybe it stabilizes it. And then maybe you could actually do the same thing really in the gravity context. Simon.
As I have shown you that the Ising spin putting on the dynamical triangulation, when you measure the fractal dimension, this is quite much consistent with an analytic result. And that's a slightly different direction from what you are doing.
Oh, it is a different direction. It's very interesting. But we know that two-dimensional random triangulation can be mapped onto matrix models, and you can solve two-dimensional string theory. So two dimensions seems to be a specially controlled environment to do random triangulation. There's really no gravity, right? No graviton flying around. So 2D is, I think, special, and that's a way, and I'm a little afraid of my one test being in 2D. I want to get out of 2D to see if I have any troubles. But 2D is wonderful. It's where random triangulation really works, and indeed, the T. Lee and Norman Crist and Friedberg, yeah. Their goal was like what you did. They wanted the random triangulation to reinstate the symmetries that the lattice has destroyed. And in fact, they wanted to get back chiral symmetry. It was one of the ways to try to fix the problem of chiral symmetry. They thought, aha, chiral symmetry is screwed up because of the lattice. And if we randomly sample lattices, then the symmetry will come back. It didn't work so far. Okay? This failed. Too bad. Nice idea.
Let's thank